Awesome, thank you. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to today's town hall. And it's not too late in the year to wish everyone a happy new year. And I hope the semester is going well as we kick off the winter 2022 semester. And thank you all for joining us today. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Ken Kettenbeil. I'm the Vice Chancellor for External Relations. And I do want to do a special call out to our students that are joining us today on the town hall. So welcome. So just a few housekeeping details before we start. You heard this session is being recorded, and we will post this on the website and have this in the reporter next week on Tuesday. We do have the chat feature turned off. So if you have any questions, please put them in the Q&A. If you submitted a question in advance, we'll start with those questions once we get to that part of the town hall. And also, Dr. Malani has to leave a little bit earlier today, so we're going to shuffle the agenda up a little bit. We're still going to have our Chancellor Domenico Grasso kick things off, but we're going to go to her quickly, and then we'll put all the health-related questions up front. So as I mentioned, today we are joined by, of course, Chancellor Domenico Grasso, Interim Provost Gabriela Scarlatta, and we're fortunate and very grateful to have our Chief Health Officer, Dr. Preeti Malani, back with us today. We love having you back, but I got to be honest, we're tired of talking about COVID. So got to bring you back when things are different.
So we can talk about something else next time.
Correct. So, thank you all for joining us. And then we also have some people that are part of the presentation that will help with questions at the end. We have our Associate Provost Maureen Linker, Mitch Sullenberger on, Dean of Students Amy Finley, Executive Director of University or Facility Operations Carol Glick, and our Director of Human Resources Rima Hungberry. So thank you all for joining us. So with that, Domenico, I'm going to throw it to you. It's a great new year, but unfortunately, the same old topic. So why don't you kick us off with a enthusiastic welcome?
Well, thank you very much, Ken. And I do want to enthusiastically wish everyone a happy new year. And as Ken said, we are pretty much stuck in the same place we were last year at this time. But we're facing a different situation. We now have vaccines, we have different variants, we've learned a lot during this process. And I want to start by saying thank you very, very much to everyone who has worked so hard to make our campus safe and a great place to work and to study. I think, and I'm pretty secure in my thinking on this, that UM-Dearborn is one of the safest, if not the safest place in southeastern Michigan. We have high vaccination rates. We are socially distanced. At the most, we have 1,250 students on campus at any one time, even though we have 7,800 enrolled on campus at any one time. We only have 1,250. We have great ventilation systems. Everyone's wearing a mask. We're requiring boosters. So we are in a very safe cocoon on this campus. And it's because of this that when we all got together and talked and thought through what our options were for this semester, we felt that we could bring people back safely, face-to-face, and offer a great education. And as you know, if we decided to go remote, as some schools have done, the whole remote aspect has with it its own set of circumstances and situations that relate to mental health and connections and the ability to be efficient in the educational process. So we took everything under consideration, and we feel, and we still feel, that this is a safe way to return to education. In the first part of this week, since Monday, we've only had 85 positive student cases, and only 5, which is about 1% of our total student body, and only 5 faculty staff cases. So I think that this is a reflection of how seriously our faculty staff and students are taking this, and they're abiding by the precautions, and we're doing a terrific job. I am confident that we will continue to be safe as we move forward, but as we've said all along, we are going to be flexible. We're going to be vigilant. We're going to monitor the situation. And if we need to make changes, we will be adaptable. So with that, I have a lot more I can say, but I will because we're dying to hear from Dr. Malani, who is the media star here. I will turn it over to her, and then I'll come back and I will provide any more information that you may want. Dr. Malani or Ken, whichever.
I'm not the media star, she is. So I'm going to kick it down to Dr. Malani. And maybe if you could start, you know, on if there's anything you wanted to, you know, add on to what the chancellor has shared and, you know, and just, you know, your assessment as to where we are. You know, I if someone would have told me back in the fall or in the summer, we would be here in this situation today, I would have said they were crazy. And maybe you're not surprised, but I know I am. And a lot of other people are. So your assessment is on the current situation.
Yeah. You know, Thank you. Thanks for having me. Happy New Year to everyone. If I'm a media star, it's one of these like, you know, sort of accidental tourist type moments. And, you know, if you asked me last January what I thought, I would have predicted that we would have been in a different situation. And there were people then who said, well, you know, variants. And I said, variants, scariants, you know, like we're gonna coast out of this. And, you know, I do want to emphasize, I'm very optimistic long-term as we do move forward. But right now we're at a moment where there's an incredible difficulty. This is a large surge related primarily to the Omicron variant. And it is affecting things. It's disrupting things. I'm glad to hear that the community at UM-Dearborn has been very careful. And, you know, again, as a state, we're running 30% positivity rates, but that number's going to come down, at least in Ann Arbor. But, you know, at a high level, what I want to say is that we're in a situation where we have a virus that it's not going to be eradicated completely long-term, but it can be managed. It can be managed very well, and we can get back to doing all the important things we need to do. What we're learning is that getting infected or even being vaccinated does not ensure long-term full immunity. And we're seeing with Omicron in particular, there is this immune escape. The idea that the protection from the vaccines and from prior infection is not 100% protective, but boosters do help that protection. And if you layer on that masks, which I know we'll talk about a little bit, you know, this is a situation where masking is actually really important. Like frankly, last summer, masking was less important. And probably even in the fall, it was less important. Although on campus, in classrooms, it remains very, very important. This is one of these situations. And, you know, in Michigan, we're used to bad weather in the winter. And like, we'll hear, okay, there's a, you know, blizzard coming in 2 days and people will go to the grocery store and they'll stock up and they'll probably stay home for a few days or they'll be careful if they are driving or they'll have snow tires. And, you know, I think in some ways, there are a lot of metaphors to think about where we're going with this, but it will be something that will be seasonal and we're going to have outbreaks and peaks. And but people who are fully vaccinated are going to do better than those who are not. And I can't emphasize this enough, but we're still in a situation in the United States where 25%, almost 25% of individuals, these are mostly adults, who are eligible for vaccination have not had a single dose of vaccine yet. And we're seeing near 100% infection in those individuals because there's so much virus out there and a portion of them are getting sick. But it's not just gloom and doom. We have made a lot of progress in terms of testing and in terms of treatment. And I know we don't need to talk about treatment today, but I do want people to look at the remarkable advances we've made in such a short period of time. And in our state, we're coming up with systems, and I say we, but really the public health authorities, to be able to get tested and be treated with oral antivirals, for example. And right now that's on a very small scale, but over time it'll be on a bigger scale. And so, you know, my hope is that we're gonna look a lot better soon, but it's probably gonna be 2, 3, 4 weeks where we're gonna be at very high levels, if not longer. But again, you know, last fall was pretty good. It was certainly good in Ann Arbor. I know it was good in Dearborn. And a lot of that had to do with the vaccination rate being very high, people being careful and thoughtful about everyone around them, and really good adherence to mask use.
Thank you. And yeah, I at least on our campus, there was a lot of compliance, cooperation. You know, we did a lot of things right. And, you know, I think that's a credit to, you know, to our community. So just for the people still joining us, if you have are still coming in, if you have questions, put them in the Q&A tab. They're already starting to come in. Dr. Malani, we received some questions in advance. So I'm going to start with those questions. Let's start with mask. It's confusing. Is it, N95s, KN95, surgical cloth? Why doesn't the university recommend or require a particular type of mask? Can you give us some guidance as to our policies and what we should do not only on campus but in our personal lives with masking?
Yeah, and I can I can share my thoughts on this. I think of it as sort of good, better, best, and like maybe even thinking about what you would wear outside today, where it's actually like to me it's actually doesn't feel that cold. It's actually pretty warm by my standards, but a couple of days ago it was really cold. So that you just like you adjust your clothing, just like you adjust the kind of shoes you might wear if it's slippery outside. I think the masks are kind of like that. And, the cloth masks are good. They're not like worthless. And the WHO still, you have to think about equity also in the world, and actually think about supply chains. 2 years ago, there were no masks to be had even for healthcare workers. So some of this was by necessity, and we went to, people made masks and, they got their sewing machines out. I would say today, at this moment, when Omicron is surging all around us, there's less utility in the cloth masks. I mean, a double-layered cloth mask still has some utility, but I personally am not wearing them right now. I was a few months ago, and I'll probably bring them back out. Some of them look nice. They have some cool designs in that. And a lined mask is still useful. What I would say today, especially when we're talking about campus, where people are coming to a workplace, or they're coming to a classroom, a research lab, a library. This is a place where people are gonna be for an extended period of time often. And so I would say the medical mask, the typical surgical mask is good. The KN95s or N95s are better. And if they're comfortable for you, that would be a good option, particularly in a classroom setting. One thing that does protect is when everyone else around you is vaccinated, but also masked. That is very important. Yesterday the computers went down at the hospital and we were joking because, it was all these infectious disease doctors sitting around unable to do anything because we didn't know where anyone was. And luckily they came back up, but there were a bunch of us in someone's office all masked up. And another colleague came by and he's like, this is going to be a super spreader event. He's just joking. But part of it is that the reason we could all be in that crowded space in the hospital is because we're all masked. In the healthcare setting, we also wear eye protection, but it's a different scenario. I'm looking in someone's mouth or, doing something to them where their secretions could get on me. That's not going to be the case in classrooms. But what I would say is that the KN95 in my personal life, I've started adapting to those when I'm out and about, when I'm traveling. I did fly over the break and my family and I wore those. If I'm going, for a walk outside, I don't wear a mask. Maybe to keep warm, but if I'm outdoors, I'm okay with that. And the N95s, I think the big thing is make sure that they're comfortable, that they fit, push down the nose piece. And they are becoming more available. I noticed that the health department in Washtenaw County, and I believe in Wayne, are having these distributions. So, not just for you, but for your family and friends. If you have children in K-12 space, I think that they are now at this moment with high transmission, a very good idea. I'm sorry, that was a long answer, but it kind of depends. And I don't want people to think that a medical mask is not useful because it is very useful.
Just to follow up on that. So if, let's just say, again, trying to wrap my head around this too. So a cloth mask, if you're running into a restaurant, for example, to pick a carryout order up, a cloth mask maybe works, but if you're going to be standing shoulder to shoulder with someone waiting in line to get into the restaurant, maybe a different type of protection might be needed.
Yeah, absolutely. And I would just say right now, restaurants, you might want to just get the carryout, to be honest, depending on the restaurant. I think that's the kind of decision that people have to make. I do think it's important to keep these restaurants open and support them, or, go to a place where, you can be seated a little bit far away and that the servers are wearing masks. You don't want to be in a situation where you're really crowded up against a lot of people, especially if they're not masked. And again, eateries, this is something that, people have to eat. So if you're running in and out, grabbing, sushi for dinner, the cloth mask is fine. It's a short-term thing, but long-term, especially in a lecture hall, where I think that is one of the settings that raises concerns on campus.
Thank you. Okay, and just for the audience, we received a few questions about this too, but we do have surgical masks and KN95 masks available at the University Center right now for pickup. You can either go to the information desk or the testing clinic when they're open, which this week is Monday through Thursday, 7:30 a.m. to 6:30 p.m. And you know, as hours fluctuate, you can decide. And then also surgical masks are in various distribution points across campus. And we have that information on our website, and we're including it in a Friday communication as well. So if you would like one, there is one for you, and Kara will talk a little bit more about that later. Dr. Malani, so this question came up, is there a particular source or sources that you recommend people listen to or read up on, or websites to consult where there's just more like consistent, up-to-date information on all things related to COVID? Are there sources?
Thanks for asking, because I think that there's a lot of information out there and not all of it's very good. I would say the local health department is actually a good source. The CDC is a good source. I personally look at the New York Times most days. The work that Apoorva Mondavilli especially has done, I have found really interesting. I've spoken to her a few times during the pandemic. I think it's interesting. She's been actually right about a lot of stuff. Sometimes when I thought maybe she was maybe overreacting, she's been right. I follow the trends and the trackers. And then the journal that I work for part-time, JAMA, the Journal of the American Medical Association, I've actually done a number of videos for them. I just did a very long discussion on vaccines, vaccine safety. It's very accessible to the you know, non-medical audience. So, you know, I think, random Facebook posts about, well, all these people died without like an attribution, things like that. You have to be a little careful. I think social media can be very helpful and useful, but it's probably not the best place to get COVID information.
I know there was something I read in it's a public relations trade magazine. And unfortunately though, a lot of people do go to social media for a lot of the news. So
for sure.
Okay. We have a lot of people on campus with young children. What is the latest information for vaccinations for people under 5 years old? And how would you recommend people keep young children safe if they're in daycare or preschool?
It's a great question. And we have some under fives in my extended family, and we had some of them over on Christmas. And I'll tell you, on Christmas, I was actually pretty worried about, we've done this big dinner every year, have Mexican food every year, don't ask, but like, that's just something that we've done it for years. Sometimes we have 50 people in our house. This year we had about 30, including a number of older adults and three children that were too young to be vaccinated. And my own family needed to travel, and it was important that we not get infected. So I had everyone wear masks other than, the little ones who can't. But what I talk about a lot is a reminder that vaccination isn't just about protecting you, it protects everyone around you. So for families that still have children that are not yet eligible for vaccination, who are understandably worried about their kids, part of that is making sure that everyone around you is fully vaccinated and boosted, making sure their caregivers are fully vaccinated, grandparents, things like that. The good news is that children are likely to become eligible soon. The younger kids, those studies were disappointing, but and part of it had to do with the dose. And I'll send a link to you. I had an extended conversation with Dr. Amanda Cohn from the CDC. It was an interview that went up a few days ago. And I asked her about this. She's a pediatrician by background. She thought probably by late spring, the kids would be eligible for vaccination. So I think there is hope that it'll happen soon, but in the meantime, making sure everyone around you is vaccinated. And for the kids, they do wear masks in school, and they're pretty good at wearing masks, but it's also just important to find ways for them to play and be outside and be with other kids. I think it's stressful for families because, it's hard to know, probably not a lot of sleepovers, things like that. I think people worry that their kids are going to infect their parents, the kids' grandparents. But find ways to move forward is what I would say. And masks are really helpful when you don't have vaccines yet.
So a booster question here. Why are boosters being required to faculty, staff, and students when there's a lot of breakthrough cases and a lot of people that are you know, up to date with their vaccinations are still contracting COVID?
Yeah, you know, this is a good question. It's a fair question. And I will say, you know, this is a novel coronavirus. We still don't know everything about it. We don't actually know what variant's going to come next. And will the next variant be completely, you know, will it completely evade immunity? I hope not, but that's possible. And, you know, the series of two vaccines for most of us, mRNA vaccine is for most of us, it's two. Some people got the Johnson & Johnson, Janssen vaccine. But that primary series still has pretty good protection, the Pfizer, Moderna, against severe infection, against hospitalization and death. And I want people to feel good about that. But what we have found is that there's waning immunity and there's also resistance. There's some data from the CDC that's going to be published in the coming days that shows that the booster does improve vaccine effectiveness against symptomatic infection. So if you break through, you don't have symptoms. And it's not the 80, 90, 95% that we saw a year ago in the first studies. It's more like 50, 60%, but it's pretty good. So by having everyone boosted, it keeps infections down in the whole community. So that's part of it. The breakthrough cases, you know, when we think about vaccination, I think that this vaccine was so incredibly effective that in a way we were spoiled. I don't know if that's the right word to use, but it was like, you know, out of the park. But you think about flu vaccine, what it does is it attenuates disease. It makes it less severe. And so you don't prevent every infection, you prevent illness. And that's the terminology I think of, is that if I get COVID, I'm not going to die of COVID. I'm not going to be hospitalized. I might be inconvenienced for a few days. And this is really where we're headed when we talk about endemicity. Like, we're not going to have life without COVID. Next January, when we're talking, hopefully it'll be in person if we have to do a town hall. And if we get COVID, we'll stay home for a couple of days and maybe come back wearing a mask. Maybe no one else will mask. I don't know where we're headed with that and what that timeline is, but vaccination remains essential to making this a mild disease, if that makes sense. You know, it doesn't eliminate all the infection, but it eliminates the illness for most of us. And importantly, if I am vaccinated and I have an infection with COVID, I'm less likely to spread. My viral load is lower and it's a shorter duration of illness.
All these questions are good, but is it possible to get multiple strains of COVID, or do you get the same strain? Can you get the same strain more than once?
Yeah, you know, this is like that. I saw some things. I didn't actually read them, but the Deltacron, right? Like, it was probably, you know, in between the pictures of dogs, Domenico and I like Labradors. So, you know, that's what social media for me. I try to look for, you know, pictures of cute dogs, because otherwise it's just a little too much vitriol for me. But, you know, what we are definitely seeing is people who were sick in the spring, who had COVID in the spring. Not necessarily sick, but we're seeing this in our students, documented COVID, they have COVID again. And like, they're not very sick, but they have some symptoms. You should have some immunity for some time. I mean, the variants have been sequential. Like, we had wild type virus and we had sort of the B117 alpha. And then we were the summer of Delta, and now we're into Omicron. And Omicron has pretty much displaced Delta. And it's very clear with Omicron, and it has to do with, it has a lot of mutations in the spike protein, which is how it enters the cells. It is just very, very different. And so the immunity from before is probably not very good. So lots of people getting reinfections with Omicron. But I don't think like 3 weeks from now or a month from now or 2 months from now, you'll get Omicron again. But we don't know.
Question about, you know, how are we, you know, using the word mild, you know, or, you know, how is the university looking at all of this collectively to determine if something is a severe outbreak, mild? You know, I mean, having anyone sick is not good.
Yeah.
You know, I think we all agree on that, but
yeah,
there are different levels, correct?
Yes, no, and there's actually a set, and I can share it with you. I'm sort of off the top of my head. There's actually, you know, there's like zero symptoms, and then there's mild, which is like, I have a stuffy nose and sore throat, but no fever. You know, moderate is like, you know, I have a fever, I feel a little crummy. And then severe is like, you know, needing to go and seek healthcare and hospitalization. But what we're seeing are either asymptomatic and mild in the students. And again, you know, faculty and staff, we don't have the same kind of level of data. We know that they're highly vaccinated, and most of them, they're mild to moderate, probably, since they're older. And probably a lot of them didn't get COVID last year. And I say that because it was pretty easy to avoid it last year. This year, it's a lot harder. Last year, you know, at this time, we were all like kind of locked up in our homes, except for students on campus who are living, you know, amongst other people. It's very, very hard to really live in that environment and not be exposed to a lot of people. You can't isolate yourself completely. So many of the people now are getting COVID for the first time. And so there's that illness is likely a little more severe too. But there is a paradigm by which you label these. It's not just me saying, oh, it's mild. There's actually a definition. And our health service has been categorizing every one of those cases that comes to their attention.
I'm just aware of your time. So do you have time for two more questions?
Yeah, sure, sure.
One is the quarantine times have changed, and the CDC just recently, you know, if you're vaccinated and you're exposed, you do X, and you know, all of that has shifted. So any insights into that? Do you agree with it? The science behind it?
Yeah. You know, I do. And I, you know, I am somebody who has confidence in the CDC. I think the messaging did get a little bit garbled, and it's unfortunate, but you know, it turns into sound bites, but you know, they don't tend to move that fast. And really, there are a couple things. This isn't just like, let it just go. This is that if you're fully vaccinated and boosted, your level of viral spread is pretty low, especially outside of your household if you're wearing a mask. And so, you know, getting people back to school is really important. And I say that as a parent. You know, I think the academic risk of all this is something that's not trivial. And doesn't mean like, you know, we want you to go to school sick if you're not feeling well, but if you're home and you're asymptomatic, it's been 5 days and we know you're fully vaccinated and boosted, you put a mask on, like you're not going to infect anyone. And some of those infections are being diagnosed because people are getting tested more readily. And, you know, this happened in my own family with one of my kids, and, you know, the rest of us didn't get infected. So it just tells you, like, even within the household, no one got infected. So the guidance changes as the pandemic changes. We learn and we move forward. And to me, that is it's a good compromise. We're not ready to just say go back, but 5 days. And, you know, and some people talk about, well, we should test and then we should do this. If you have access to testing and you feel better with it, that's great. But that recommendation, it doesn't mean go back to, you know, go to the bar, to a party. It means you can get back to class. And I think that is important that people take responsibility and still understand that they could be shedding small bits of virus, but they're not missing 2 weeks of school, if that makes sense.
So final question, in the JAMA article, you know, you talked about like what the country, well, you were involved in the article, like what does the country need to do going forward? At some point, there's going to be a shift in right philosophy and how we deal with things. And, you know, I know you don't have a crystal ball, but when might that happen? But, you know, more importantly, like, what do you see? What should the suggested way forward be, you know, when the time's right?
Yeah, I'm glad you asked that, Ken. You know, just a little plug for these articles. They're available free. And they're just interesting reads. So the people who wrote them, there are six authors total. They were advisors to the Biden transition team. So from last November to January, and they're really sort of stalwarts in the health policy world. And it's interesting, it's that we're not gonna have a world free of COVID, but that we're gonna vaccinate, boost, mask. And they talk a lot about like getting masks to people, like what you said, you know, that you could go to the testing site, you could go to the, you know, the student center, the union, you can go pick up a mask. And those are the kind of things we need to talk about. We also need a system where we can test people and treat them. And we can treat them early, because people who are medically vulnerable, COVID is not going to end easily for them. You know, that you're going to remain vulnerable. And I think we have to really have a lot of empathy for people who, you know, their families, there's someone very vulnerable in their family. And they haven't been able to, quote, get back to normal because there's so much COVID in the community. But can we come up with situations where, besides vaccinating and boosting, we can also tie testing and treatment close together. And in a nation where a lot of people still don't have a primary care provider, are not regularly seeking care, there's a lot of things that need to be built around public health. But I am hopeful that perhaps even later this year, this is going to be much more of a, you know, something we can manage. And, you know, with these tests that are about to arrive in our mailbox, I'm like waiting. I think they're coming soon. And you know, we'll have plenty of these lateral flow assays where if people aren't feeling well, they test themselves and then they stay home. And I think that piece, which is unimaginable a year ago, is something that is very, really realistic for the coming days. And, you know, in the meantime, I would just say my message is be hopeful, but also find ways to do things that are really meaningful for you. You know, like if something's really important to you, find a way to do it. Find a way to do it as safely as possible. I recognize that things don't look exactly the way we want them to look yet. We're not gonna go back to 2019, but 2022 should be a better year than 2021.
Ken, I'd just like to ask Dr. Malani two quick questions, and I hope they're quick answers. One is, do you have any information on long COVID? And two, is there, and I think I know the answer to this because it's like the flu, is there any difference if you contract COVID as a disease from the Omicron or the Delta or the Alpha variant? Is the disease presentation any different? So,
yeah. Yeah, so those are good questions. The second question is probably easier. There is a suggestion from the data so far that the Omicron variant causes less severe disease. Now, that doesn't mean everybody, especially if you're not vaccinated. And it may be that it's confounded a little bit because so many people are vaccinated who are experiencing this. But in terms of the proportion of people who are becoming very ill, and disease, this is what happens, right? Disease gets modified. We move from pandemic to endemic. The other piece, Domenico, around long COVID is harder. And, you know, I don't understand that. And I don't think other people do yet either. And when you have millions of people every day getting infected, even if it's a very small portion, that end up with these prolonged symptoms, these non-specific, but very debilitating symptoms, that's not a good thing. And there is some neurologic issue that happens to some people. And this, you know, people lose their sense of smell and taste. So it has this neurotrophic quality. This virus does get into the nerves. But why some people instead of others? You know, does vaccination prevent it? Vaccination probably decreases risk, but it doesn't eliminate it. And, you know, this is just one more reason. And, you know, again, just talking about what I'm doing personally, I've kind of like after I came back from the holidays, I've been sort of home, you know, going to work, getting tested because I had, you know, a lot of travel and family exposures during the break. But you know, this weekend, I'm planning to get together with my good friends because, you know, they're following pretty good guidance and so are we. And I really want to see them. I miss them. And so, you know, we're not having 50 people over, but I'm still finding ways to connect in a meaningful way. And I, you know, I hope all of us can do that because otherwise it's going to be a long, long year. And, you know, at the same time, not to take unnecessary risks and put other people at risk.
That's good advice. Thank you. So yeah, we definitely will take you up on an in-person offer when the time is right.
Yeah, I love coming. So I'll come whenever it's appropriate.
Good. Well, thank you again for joining us.
Take care, guys.
Stay healthy, stay safe, and we'll turn it back over to the leadership side. Thank you.
Bye.
Okay, Chancellor, is there anything you wanted to respond to or add on what Dr. Malani had to share?
I would like to add a couple of things. First, I want to reiterate to everyone that we have a testing clinic that's on campus and available to anyone who wants to be tested. You can come, even if you're working from home and you just want to come and get tested, as long as you don't have symptoms, if you're not symptomatic, you can come to campus and get tested if you're concerned, especially if you don't have access to a rapid test kit that you purchased or at another site. The second thing is, and Dr. Malani hinted at this, and I read the same things that she does in the New York Times, so I follow this. And the headline today was, is Omicron peaking? And there is starting to be evidence that some cities are starting to see a plateau, New York and Chicago being two of the most notable. There are other cities like Boston that are still on the rise. But when I looked at the positivity data from the State of Michigan health site today, I started to see a plateau of positivity rates in both Washtenaw County and the state as a whole. And I think that those are leading indicators that we're going to start to see a plateau of cases as well. The original estimate for Omicron plateauing was January 9th. I think we're a little bit behind that, but I think that we're going to start to see a plateauing of the Omicron variant very soon. So I'll leave it at that, and I'd be happy to answer questions, Ken. It's up to you how you wanna.
Yep. Go. So why don't the rest of the panelists here, if you can turn your cameras on, we'll go into the questions that we're receiving both online live and then the ones that have been submitted previously. So Carol, masking, there's a suggestion here that we maybe put signage up in buildings indicating where those masks are located. You know, I think that's a good suggestion. We can talk about that. Can you want to comment on, I think there was a limited supply of KN95s that we had, but more are coming in. And then there's a question here about how long can these masks be reused? Can they be cleaned? I believe KN95s are only good for a certain period of time and they have to be disposed of. Can you speak to both those things?
I'm happy to speak to these. So in terms of how long they're good for or when they need to be disposed of, that's not my area of expertise and I don't have an answer for that. However, we would be happy to put signage on doors. I think that's a good suggestion. And I think we should be able to get signage around tomorrow, at least to the main entrances. In terms of where we have masks located, surgical masks we have located at various places around the campus, in all of the dean's offices, in at the UC, at both the information desk and the testing center, the ELB advising office, in CSS at facilities operations at the reception area, and in AB at human resources. We also have KN95 masks for people that are more comfortable with those at the university center and at the Fairlane Center in both of the dean's offices. And we'll continue, of course, to just make sure that those supplies are updated as we go through the next few weeks. Chancellor.
Ken, the CDC recommends that N95 or KN95 masks should be used no more than 5 times.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, Rima and Gabriella, there's a couple of questions that came in about, there are work schedule related. So one is if there's family hardship, where maybe children are sick and they're going to have to stay home. So about the getting the flexibility to maybe work remote or hybrid, suggestions, where should faculty and staff go first and then to navigate that process?
So I'll take a quick stab, but obviously, Gabriella, please pipe in. We encourage employees, talk to your supervisor. If you're a faculty member, talk to your department chair. Just explain the situation. What we're telling folks is right now, this is the time we want to be as flexible as possible. So if you've got kids who are at home, right, in isolation or quarantining, or if there's a childcare situation, we want to be able to pivot to being at home if we need to be. If you wake up and you're not feeling good, you've got symptoms, you've had exposure in your household, just be really thoughtful and careful around whether or not it's safe and appropriate to come to campus. If you're not sure, reach out to us in HR, talk to your department chair. There are just a list of resources out there for you to go out and talk to someone if you're not sure, and we can help determine next steps. Gabriella, anything about the teaching side of things you want to speak sure. to?
Yes, thank you, Rima. And I want to thank everybody for joining us, first of all, today, but also for your return to campus and for being back teaching our students, working in your offices, and serving our community. That's very important. So we really appreciate you being back. And I think that Dr. Malani said it, it's a good thing to be back on campus and seeing our students, and they need it. So we have stressed in the provost email from last week, flexibility. Please be flexible with our students. If they contact you because they're positive that cannot be in class, please help them with continuing their learning journey with on-campus material. Please be there for them. and same for you. If you don't feel, if you feel sick that day, if you feel something is up, please let your chair know. Please let your students know right away on Canvas. Let them know I'm moving my classes to online today and tomorrow, this week, simply because I need to, if you want. And then come back the following week, come back when you have a negative test, or that's what we want. This whole month, if you want, we want it to be back because we really felt that it was safe. But if there are circumstances, please take care of yourself, communicate with your chair, and do what you think is best. And do, I appreciate the emails I received. I appreciate the dialogue I've had with faculty council, who is concerned, obviously, but I think that we are just here to help each other, and flexibility is really what is needed right now.
And sort of staying in that same vein, not necessarily if I'm sick today, but you know, we're going on 2 years of a very unique work environment. And this question comes up typically when we do host town halls, but you know, there's still questions about, are some positions just going to remain virtual or remote forever? And you know, I think that's a question and a dialogue with the supervisor. And you know, Rima, Gabriella, if there's anything you wanted to add to that.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely true. And we've said it before, this pandemic has taught us quite a bit about the way we perform our jobs, right? And things that we would never imagine we could do remotely, we're finding out that we can not only do it remotely, but we can do it very well remotely, right? So it's consideration of all of these factors and just being open and flexible to things that may look different. Now, a year from now, when maybe there's a greater density of us on campus, we might have to shift a little further, but we are gonna take all the lessons that we've learned over the past 2 years. We're going to apply them in such a way that people have job satisfaction to the best of our ability. And if that means hybrid or more remote, it could mean all of those things. We just don't know yet.
Agreed. But we do know that some of our faculty, most of our faculty actually, want to be back on campus. We know that a lot of our students want to be back on campus. So for the faculty side, I think that we will continue to try to be on campus like we were pre-COVID. Some courses were very soundly pedagogically delivered online, and that's great. Some need to be on campus, you know, the labs, the senior projects and other courses. And so that is my hope, that we'll be able to be back to where we do our job best.
So I think the second most common question we received in advance and we're receiving now live, right after, why didn't we start, do a virtual remote, is what are we gonna do to enforce the mask policy? You know, people have provided lots of instances where they've seen students, primarily some faculty and staff, maybe that are not wearing a mask or wearing them properly. I guess this question maybe goes to all the senior leaders. You know, the library was mentioned. I know today in our senior leader meeting, you know, the chancellor asked all of us, you know, to, you know, reinforce what the policy is with their staff in classrooms with students. When we see people walking in buildings without masks, you know, we should remind people in a polite way. But, you know, Domenico, Maureen, Amy, do you want to comment on enforcement and compliance with this particular area?
Sure, I'd be happy to. I just want to start by saying that it's really important that if you are in a situation where you see people who are non-compliant, if you feel comfortable to say something, then you should. Another example of something you can do is call the COVID hotline and let us know. So for example, when we receive those calls, we're able to follow up with the instructor of that class or the chair or the dean and just make sure we're reiterating to all the people involved the importance of mask wearing. As Dr. Malani said, that's an important part of our keeping our campus safe. And if we do have folks who continue to be non-compliant, it certainly can be brought to my team's attention and we can have a conversation with the student. We aren't generally finding a lot of repeat offenders, has been my experience, but it really, you know, it really relies on our campus community to come together and say, this is just an expectation we have of each other to keep each other safe.
Maureen, did you maybe want to comment on efforts in the library? It's a popular gathering spot, of course.
It is, and shout out to my library folks for all the work they've been doing to keep the library open through finals and into the new semester. Yeah, it's an issue. We see students taking off their masks, you know, when they're studying. I mean, of course, if students are eating or drinking, there, you know, we don't want to prevent that from happening. There are students who are using the library for all the right reasons. The library belongs to our campus and to our students. So we want people to feel comfortable there and work there. But we really try to avoid it being confrontational. We're an educational institution. And so we are trying to promote the value in the education of masking. So we welcome everyone on our campus, faculty, staff, and students to help us do that. I think one of the things we've done is sort of point to the students who don't have their masks on and remind them to put them on. It would help if we had everybody doing that. We did this kind of collectively and together. And what I often do is if I encounter a student who isn't wearing a mask or someone on campus, excuse me, I'll say, I want to keep you safe. So please put your mask on, right? So that's where we are. It's not a perfect system, but we don't want to police either, right? We don't want to have, we have campus safety as a last resort for any sort of aggressive responses we've gotten. Fortunately, they've been very few. But we're trying to lead with education first. And again, collective action. This needs to be a community effort and not something that's on the shoulders of any one unit or one team.
There's a couple questions here. You know, some people have pointed to repeat offenders, you know, with the masking policy. I think it's fair to say that if they know who they are, if there's issues, that maybe call the COVID support line, and, you know, Amy's team can get involved with, you know, who these individuals are and, you know, come to an appropriate solution, you know, so
yeah. Things can stop. Let me just reiterate what the phone number and the email address are so that people can get a hold of us if they need to. So our phone number is 313-593-5056, and we can be reached by email at dearborncovidsupport@umich.edu. And I just wanted to mention, as I saw something in the chat, we have had occasions where if someone is not willing to comply, we indeed have asked them to leave the building. So if we approach them and we say, hey, this is a gentle reminder that we do have an indoor masking policy and they are unwilling, we will eventually ask them to leave the building if they are unwilling to comply. So yes, that is something. Very limited occasions have we had to do that, but that is something we would be prepared to do because it is our policy.
And there's a question that came in about, you know, maybe a faculty member not or faculty not being as accommodating as Gabriella has requested. You know, those students should contact the support line as well. I know Amy and I were talking this week. I mean, the work that Amy's team is doing with the support line is to do that, support people and to bring about good solutions, you know, where, you know, people are happy and healthy and safe. And, you know, it's not about policing and enforcement. It's about working together and helping and coming up with the right solutions. So we can't stress that number enough. And, you know, again, Amy and team Maddie are doing a fantastic job, and it's hard work, but it's good work. It's important work, and people are there to help. You know, I think that's what I think the message is we want to convey today. Research labs that are 24/7. I don't know who wants to take that. You know, we're not quite there with, you know, access to buildings like we had in 2019. I don't know if there's a crystal ball when that may change, or Carol, like, so you have your hand up.
So the notice around 24/7 access for faculty conducting research. So what we have not done is we have not opened the buildings themselves 24/7 because we're still trying to manage access to our campus community. However, research faculty members who need to have 24/7 access should simply work through their DACs and get that requested with their MCARD. There's no reason at this point that researchers who need to be accessing buildings 24/7 should not be able to do so. It's just a slightly different process than it was in the past.
Yeah, if I can add something, Ken, and thank you, Carol. I have to say that I've had a couple of faculty members. We discussed it with the chairs, and I contacted Carol, and right away, Carol was able to grant access to the labs and to the offices of these faculty members. So I encourage you to please talk to your chairs, and the chairs can talk to the dean, and we can make those requests. So we're trying to keep the campus safe, but definitely we want you to continue your research, absolutely, and get to your you know, materials. So please just let us know and go through the chair dean channel.
There's a question here, and this also came up during our leadership meeting this morning about why don't we have door screeners looking for the responsive blue apps like we did at the beginning of the fall semester? Why aren't we doing that for the winter semester? Any of my panelists want to take that?
I think it's as I can start, and please, everybody, feel free to help. It's a matter of resources, and it's a matter of policing. Like we announced at the beginning of the town hall, our vaccination rate is up. It's not like it was back in September, right? Back in September, remember when we started, the vaccination mandate started August 31st, and we had some students who needed to, and frankly, faculty and staff, and faculty that were going through the summer, now our vaccination rate is up. So we don't feel we are in that dire situation.
I would agree. I would just add on to that. That was a great bottleneck to be able to share information with students about what the expectations were around not only submitting their vaccination and coming into compliance with the policy, but with our masking mandate and just answering questions. And I also think, and I know I'm not alone when I say this, it was really lovely for some of us to be able to have that experience to interact with our students as they were coming back and deliver a personal greeting and welcome back to our campus.
I agree. Question here about, you know, if there are continued hardships about being able to offer some level of in-person office hours, I think those should be directed to HR. Would you agree, Rima? I mean, we can
work. Yeah, absolutely. Got a situation where an office can't be there in person. Work with my office. Your supervisor's leadership will find a way to make it work. I mean, again, like I said, you know, the first part of this pandemic, we were virtually remote. I mean, there was very few people on campus, essential services that had to be here. But for the most part, we were remote, right? So we don't want to forget everything we learned about how we did that and we did it well. So if we're in a situation now where for a short-term period of time, someone's ill, someone in your family's ill, and you have to be remote, we'll find a way to make it work.
A question here about allergy symptoms being very close to some of the COVID systems, particularly in how the questions are asked on the responsive blue app. I'll attempt to answer that go get a test would be the safest thing to do if there's doubt.
Yeah. We're encouraging folks, if you're just not sure, something feels off, you've got some sort of symptom. I'm not a medical doctor. I'm not trying to play one either. Just go out and get tested and stay home. Don't come to campus until you're cleared.
All right. Well, we have a couple minutes. So any final thoughts from any of our panelists? I'll let Domenico have the final word before, you know, I wrap it up. But anyone on panelists want to say anything before I turn it over to the chancellor?
I would like to, again, to thank everybody, and it takes a campus, right, to make it work. And we really wanna be there for our students, for each other. So let's keep wearing masks, whether it's the K95 or the medical for each other. And I was gonna add a little something. I think it has been said, but I can't stress it enough that our mission is educating. And so if we see a student that does not have a mask, that is an educational moment for us. And we can use kind words and just make sure that that student understands the importance of wearing it. There's no need to escalate, and simply reminding them, I think what I found a lot of students that were not wearing it at the end of the semester, and I think it was probably semester fatigue and finals and et cetera, but we just need to talk to our students like you would be talking to them in a classroom or in an office. That's all.
So before I give it to you, Domenico, there's a few questions that came in, and one I should have addressed. But when the communication went out I think it was last week, definitely the end of December, all the processes were not in place for people to upload their booster vaccination cards. So that happened over the holidays. And so that was communicated. It will be communicated on Friday. We're going to have another communication coming out. And not a surprise, but they're severely backlogged on the people that have started, much like what we experienced in the fall. It's sort of repeating now in the winter. There's only so many resources to process thousands of these cards. So enforcement and information about what happens will not really be determined until February. So we have a ways to go. There's data, you know, that needs to be worked out and how things are communicated with people here on our campus from the IT department in Ann Arbor that's helping coordinate this. So there's definitely more to come. I think sometimes there's still more questions than answers in all cases, but we're catching up and we're getting there. So Domenico, I'll throw it to you for final words and then I'll wrap things up.
Thanks very much, Ken. And I did want to just follow up on what you just said, Ken, and to let people know, and I don't think we talked about this, is that booster shots are available at the clinic. So if you want to get a booster shot, you can go there. It's free, and you can get your booster shot if you don't already have one. And there's no appointment needed. You just walk in. I walked in today to get tested, and the place was totally empty, and it's a 10-minute test. If you want to get a booster, it's even less time than that. So I encourage you to get tested and to get your booster shot. I do want to wrap up by saying thank you again to everybody who is being flexible, adaptive, helping us make this work on our campus. I want to assure you that we've got a lot of bright people working very hard, looking at the data on a frequent basis to make sure that we can keep mission first, but think about our people always. And we meet frequently, and we're trying to take care of everybody, make sure everybody's safe, and we're trying to be flexible as well. Flexible around work schedules, around teaching schedules, around everything that we can do to make it a welcoming place so that we can offer the great education that we're known for and keep everybody safe and functioning. So I do want to thank everybody. I want to thank especially my staff, because they are outstanding. This is the best staff in America. I can assure you of this. And they have done a tremendous job of working together to keep everyone's safe. So thank you all, and thank you everybody out there for being part of our community. Ken, I'll turn it back over to you.
All right, no, thank you. I just a few other additional thank yous. Miriam Sharaf, who's our new administrative assistant for a variety of departments on campus. This was her first webinar. Thank you, did great. I told you it would be great. And also the continued support from IT. Anitra, again, thank you for being on the call. You're the backbone, you make this happen. We are gonna start the weekly COVID communications on Friday afternoons. We have one going out tomorrow that's gonna address some of the issues that came up today. And, you know, again, I just want to underscore between the COVID Support Center for Students and HR, you know, we're here to help. And some of the questions that came in were, they seem to be very personal and, or, you know, personal circumstances that maybe weren't appropriate for this forum. But there's people here to help, and there's people to, you know, bring things to a really good conclusion. So again, Happy New Year. Thank you. We'll do this again when needed. Have a good semester and a good rest of the week. Bye, everyone.
I'm blue.